Welcome back to the OCADU Sports Report. My name is Avishai Sol. I am your host, and if you missed me last week, it's because I had COVID. For the first time, too. It's been a while, and I've been Bo Jackson out here with the COVID. I've been ducking and weaving, breaking tackles. COVID could not catch me. I was slipping the motherfucker. But everyone gets tackled eventually, and I got it. I got the vid. I succumbed to the disease. Luckily, I felt fine. I just had a little cold, but I did have to quarantine for a few days.
Ooh, snatch back. Bang. Got him. Steps back. Fire. Bang. Bang. And he dances on him. He shows off. He dances on him.
But that just means that we have even more content to cover on this episode because we got 2 weeks in the bag. And that's what we're going to do. We have so much to go over in the world of sports, and let's get into it. Starting off in the world of soccer, the controversy surrounding Cristiano Ronaldo's contract with Manchester United is sort of coming to a head, and it looks like Ronaldo is going to get his way because Manchester is looking for a way to terminate it. And they're done with the drama. They're just, get out of here, Ronaldo. It's interesting because we see in a lot of American sports the sort of laissez-faire way people are able to get out of contracts and hot teams if they want is often looked down on by the traditional sports fans and see it as a sort of form of disloyalty. Soccer was one of those sports where that loyalty is still held in high regard. And Ronaldo's recent antics have been rubbing a lot of fans the wrong way, but it's interesting to see him get his way here, because that could be a precursor for things to come. If you remember back in the early 2000s, NBA players were starting to sort of bristle against their contract and try to force their way out of their markets through trades. It was painful and it was annoying and they got a lot of flack for it, but they were successful in the end most of the time. Of course, that would evolve to now where people can just hop teams whenever they want. So it'll be interesting to monitor how this recent evolution with Ronaldo, and more specifically, how he was able to get his way in the end, will carry out and evolve over the next 2 years with players changing teams. Next, moving on to the world of football. Titans running back Derrick Henry might be threatening to win the MVP of the entire league. This past week, Henry became the first player with at least 20 carries, 2 completions, a rushing touchdown, and a touchdown pass in the same game since the immortal Walter Payton did so in 1983. He's incredible, and especially in this era of quarterback dominance, where the running game isn't quite as valuable as it might have been 20 years ago, it's interesting to see a player like Henry dominate in the fashion he is. Now, moving on to the world of tennis. There was some controversy with Novak Djokovic. He needed a visa to play in the Australian Open. He didn't have one. I don't know how he could be going to all the tournaments he was already going to if he didn't have a visa, but apparently he needs one now, and I think he got one. So, way to go, Novak. But in some more tennis news, there's a bit of a social shift here as Wimbledon, who formerly required all of its participants to wear pure white uniforms, is changing that dress code attire. Why? Because everybody can see through those uniforms when people sweat. There's a hot day at Wimbledon and people are sweating in their white clothes and everyone can see my bra. We're getting a lot of underwear shots. Wimbledon changed that policy and are now saying that while you still have to wear white on the outside, you can wear different colored underclothes to sort of cover that up. Next in the world of hockey, the New Jersey Devils are on a 10-game win streak. The Penguins kind of suck, the Leafs are kind of mid, and I have a hot take alert, so put on your hot take hats. The Rangers are going to beat the Colorado Avalanche in the Stanley Cup. That's right, I'm calling it right now. The New York Rangers, they have Shesterkin in net. They have Zibanejad. They have Panarin. They have all the pieces. Lafreniere, the young man, coming up, getting good. Could New York become a hockey town? I know they'll always love their baseball, and God knows their football teams aren't doing anything of note. The Knicks are bad, the Nets are a mess. Could the Rangers sort of steal the momentum in the Big Apple for the time being? It'll be interesting to see. Now, moving on to some basketball news. Our Toronto Raptors are struggling to keep players on the floor. Just a bunch of annoying, nagging injuries, whether it's a sprained ankle here or a twisted thing here, or Pascal Siakam slipped on a wet spot on the floor and stretched his groin. It's just silly stuff, but we're short man now, and we're slogging through these games. Luckily, we're still managing to win because our team is so deep. We have talent on the entire roster, not just at the top, but we are definitely missing our best players. But that's not what I wanted to talk about. What I want to talk about is a recent game the Raptors had against the Miami Heat. You might remember that the Miami Heat are the team that the Raptors traded Kyle Lowry to a couple years ago. You all remember Kyle Lowry, of course. Now, Lowry is older now, and he is playing decently on the Heat. He's not nearly the player he was when he was with the Raptors, and at some level, he'll always be considered a Raptor. When he retires, he'll get his number retired, and he'll always be considered a Raptor no matter what. He's played on other teams, but he's a Raptor. He's known as the GROAT, the greatest Raptor of all time. Now, when we traded him a couple years ago, I was not worried about losing his services on the court, because you could already start to see it that last year with the Raptors. You could already start to see the slip coming. He wasn't quite as productive offensively, he wasn't as aggressive, he was slower, he was an aging basketball player, and these things happen, but I wasn't sorry to see him go for his contributions on the court. We could get those from other places and with other people. But what I was worried about was losing his cultural impact. Kyle Lowry is one of the great culture guys of the past 20 years. He took a team with DeMar DeRozan, who, while he is a superstar scorer, is not exactly a leader, he's not a force of personality. He took a team with DeMar DeRozan. Remember, we had Andrea Bargnani, who was one of the all-time jagoffs we've ever had. A team with some talent, but no passion, no oomph, no yuchus. And Kyle Lowry took that and by sheer force of will turned it into a team not just to be considered talented, not just to be considered good and a contender, but a team to be feared. We were never going to give up. And that's the Lowry identity. And when we traded him away, I was worried that we would lose that, because there's a huge difference between having some guy in the locker room carry that emotional fortitude throughout the course of a season, but without him, would that stay? Would that culture he built leave when he did? The year after he left, last year, we saw players take the reins, take the leadership. That's Pascal Siakam, that's Fred VanVleet. Guys who have played with Lowry, who imparted some of that identity into their own games and their own leadership styles, and they were doing similar things. They were carrying on Lowry's legacy with the Raptors, with their play. And that was great, but I still had my suspicions, because it's one thing to have the guy on the floor, on the team. And it's another thing if after he leaves, the guys who he played with remember those skills and remember that mindset and that never say die attitude, and they play with it themselves. That's great. I'm glad that happened, but what about the next generation? What about Scottie Barnes, who was a rookie last year and never once played alongside Kyle Lowry? What about Delano Banton? What about Precious Achiuwa? What about the guys who've never once played with Lowry? Will they imbibe that identity and that Raptors mentality that Lowry brought? And I am happy to say that yes, they have. This is why this is a happy story and why I am smiling right now. Because it's not just Lowry's impact in the organization when he's here. It's not just his impact on his teammates who carry on his legacy after he left the team. It's the fact that he fundamentally changed the mindset of the entire organization. And we're seeing that not just a generation later, but now two generations later, a whole step removed from the Lowry era on the Raptors. And we're seeing it stay. And we're seeing it affect the way we play. It's great to watch. But now moving on to our main segments, which is the world of fight sports. We're going to start in MMA, where last week, former lightweight champion Frankie Edgar had his last fight. After 17 years and 36 fights, the Hall of Famer decided to hang up the gloves. And unfortunately, he couldn't pull out a win in his final bout. He got knocked the fuck out by Chris Gutierrez.
It allows guys to build.
It's a little bittersweet seeing a former champion, a Hall of Famer, on the ground like that. He got knocked out, man. But that was just a precursor to the fight later that night. The main event of that night was the legendary last style bender, middleweight champion Israel Adesanya duking it out with his challenger Alex Pereira. Now, Adesanya was the 2-1 favorite going into that fight. He's probably the most famous MMA fighter in the world today. He's got pizzazz, he's got striking power, he's got personality, and he has the skills to back it up. But he got knocked out in the fifth round. And it was sort of weird. I don't know what his mentality was going into it, but Adesanya was winning rounds, right? You could tell he was showing Pereira superior fighting ability. He was sort of beating him straight up, but he was beating him by the numbers. And then halfway through the fifth round, Pereira landed a punch, landed another, and before he knew it, the fight was over, and Adesanya lost. I'm just reporting that for now. I'll make a point later. Keep it in mind, though, because we're moving on to the world of boxing, where Canelo Alvarez lost to Dmitry Bivol. Remember, I've talked about Canelo Alvarez on this show. I've talked about how he's the most entertaining boxer in the sport today, how he's got incredible head movement, knockout power. He's got skills, and he is so, so sexy. But again, a superstar fighter, a champion, and someone who has the fame to garner a fan base watching that fight, lost against the odds. Now with Alvarez, it's a little different than Adesanya, because Alvarez, he's a middleweight fighter and he was attempting to move up a weight class, become the light heavyweight champion of the world. Bivol is bigger than him, and Alvarez has never been able to snag the light heavyweight belt. So while it was a loss, it wasn't a straight up loss. It's more forgivable. These fighters who we love, these Hall of Famers, these champion fighters, often end their careers getting either knocked out like Frankie Edgar, or it's not a smooth ride ever. But I will have endless patience for Alvarez. I forgive him trying to move up a weight class and do that. It's ambition. It's a drive, and I respect it. And he's still very precious to me. Canelo Alvarez, still my favorite.
It's a little bit funny, this feeling inside. Not one of those who can easily hide. And I don't have much money, but boy, if I did, I'd buy a big house where we both could live. If I was a sculptor, then again, no. Or a man who makes potions in a traveling show. Yeah, I know it's not much, but it's the best I can do. My gift is my song, man. This one's for you.
It's for you, Canelo. Keep trying.
You can tell everybody this is your song. It may be quite simple, but now that it's done, I hope you don't mind, I hope you don't mind that I put down in words how wonderful life is when you're in the world.
This is going on the internet, and I don't know if I'm ever going to be able to live that down, but we'll find out. And finally, our final segment, this week's Athlete of the Week. This week's Athlete of the Week is me. I got over COVID. That's why I'm the Athlete of the Week. I killed it. I beat it. Disease killed thousands of people, not me. This has been the OKU Sports Report. My name is Avishai Sol, and I will see you all next week.